Hi there, my name's Brian Lipworth from the Scottish Centre for Respiratory Research, University of Dundee in Scotland. Today I'd like to discuss briefly our recent paper in Allergy looking at the real-life indirect case-match comparison of Dupilumab and Tezepelumab using airway oscillometry. The methods that we employed were a real-life, pairwise, indirect case matching of patients who had been receiving either dupilumab or tezepelumab by our MDT for uncontrolled severe type 2 high asthma. The cases were matched in pairwise fashion by baseline values for peripheral airway resistance as R5, R20, body mass index, because that can also impact on peripheral resistance, inhaled corticosteroid dose, and also the treatment duration. These are the baseline matching values, and as you can see, they were very well matched. Crucially, you can see that for peripheral resistance, the R5, R20, the values were identical, as were the confidence intervals, which are not shown here. And also the values for the peripheral airway compliance as AX, also measured by oscillometry, were also identical. Now that's really important because it means that there is the same potential room for improvement. And normally we would say that a value for peripheral resistance greater than 0.1 or peripheral compliance greater than 1.0 is an abnormal value. And the treatment duration on the biologic was also very similar at around 8 months. So this is the main finding, and this is shown as the mean percentage difference in peripheral resistance, R520, or peripheral compliance, AX, and also shown on the bottom is the mean percentage difference in FEV1, and the lines represent the confidence intervals, and the red dot represents the mean percentage difference. So by definition, if a confidence interval excludes zero, then that means it is a significantly different effect, and a change to the right shows a difference in favor of dupilumab over tezepelumab. So dupilumab and tezepelumab produced a greater improvement in peripheral resistance and compliance, R520 and AX, whereas for FEV1, the biologics, as you can see, were not significantly different. And there, the confidence interval, although wider, was symmetrical around the zero line, which is also shown as a dotted interrupted line. Notably, both of the biologics for the within treatment effect did significantly improve oscillometry values as peripheral resistance and compliance. So they were both effective. It's just that dupilumab produced a significantly greater improvement than tezepelumab. So in summary, both biologics, dupilumab and tezepelumab, improved small airways function. Secondly, the improvement seen with dupilumab was significantly greater than tezepelumab, and we think the explanation for this is that in human small airways, a key paper by Manson in JCI showed that there is expression of IL-4 and IL-4-13 and not IL-5 in human small airways. And so we think the explanation for the greater effect of dupilumab than tezepelumab is this, is that downstream blockade of IL-4 and IL-13 expression with dupilumab may obviate persistent IL-13 activity due to upstream escape of IL-33 with tezepelumab. So while tezepelumab blocks the upstream epithelial alarmin TSLP, it does not block the upstream epithelial alarmin IL-33, which in down, which in turn affects downstream expression of IL-4 and IL-13. So thank you very much for your attention today, and to listening for the video.